Dear students, are you hearing my voice? Yeah, right. This is my screen. Today we are going to see about tribal movements in India, because this is the third paper we are in, tribal and pigeon movements in 19th and 20th centuries. Okay, so before going to these pigeon movements in India, first of all we'll see about the tribal movements. Okay, so what are the important tribal movements which taken place in India up to the 1947, and from this 1857 to and it around 1857 to 1947. Okay, so many number of movements has taken place. For this tribal movements, you are well aware that number of causes you are aware, and number of tribes which involved in these movements in various parts of in various parts of colonial India basically. Okay, so basically in colonial India. And we'll see the introduction part. First of all, such tribes, such tribal movements, which is happened in the regions of various types like Chuars, Kols, Bhils, Santals, Borans, Hos, Hays, Manipuris, and Garos, which organized these uprisings against oppression of the English East India Company and the British administration also. Okay, so due to the colonial exploitation, basically the tribal movement has started in India. Okay, so not only this colonial exploitation, and number of other reasons also you find, like the torture of landlords and zamindars, and sometimes these landlords and zamindars who capture the whole lands of these tribals. You are well aware that the tribal people who are living just far away from the main society and far away from the main region basically. Okay, so where they are living in and around certain forest areas, where they find important forest products to consume them, and also they want to sell to the others as a part of their livelihood. Okay, so where they get important forest products, and they also see certain important things where they will get sufficient water and pleasant climate and fertile soil. Okay, so all these are the reasons why they living far away from the main society basically. Okay, so and these areas where the forest where these tribal people were living were also grabbed by the others other non-tribal people. And there is a important thing we have to discuss here, that the tribals had lack of certain money, and there is a certain crisis of finance. Okay, so due to that, these tribal people were easily depending on these money lenders or landlords. Okay, so taking this as an advantage, these landlords and money lenders were as a guarantee of these tribal lands, and they are giving amount to these tribes at a higher rate of interest, and then when they are unable to pay their amount to the money lender or to the landlord, already they kept as a guarantee of their lands, so that whenever they are unable to pay their debt, again at the same moment the landlords and peasants, landlords and money lenders capture the lands of tribals. Okay, so which is a important criteria, usual criteria, which followed by these money lenders and various landlords at the time. Okay, so and when you see other causes, where the colonial rule India produced several new policies and had deleterious consequences for the indigenous population of the country, and in the broadest sense, the British approach the jungles with an overarching goal of bringing primitive peoples under the control of modern and centralized bureaucracy. Okay, this led to the official classification of tribal population as a cheap example was the institution of the Criminal Tribes Act 1871, which sought to control the movement of certain tribes with a history of criminal activity. Okay, so but under the act, all members of designated tribe were considered as criminals, even if they had never committed a crime, which led to widespread social stigmatization. Okay, so and another certain causes, another factors which led these tribals to fight against this colonial exploitation and the policies of British, that form of modernization and modern transport system, these British government started constructing railway lines and constructing roads which connecting the various places, basically. Okay, so which connecting connecting dockyards and also connecting various factories and various settlements which is developed by these Britishers at that time. Okay, so whenever they constructing these roads or railway lines, these lines which going through the lands of particular tribes are through the various tribal regions, and at the moment these tribal people were they have to lose their lands and without any compensation from the British like that. Okay, so at that time also these tribes were revolt against the British. Okay, and in certain times, like these, due to this means of transport and modern means of transport, and certain tribes who had their occupation like carrying those grains from one place to the another, and forest products from one place to the another, and crops which is grains from one person to another, and selling and purchasing is certain occupations which is followed by some of the tribes at that time. Okay, so due to modern ways of transport, they lost their livelihood. Okay, because due to invention of these railways and roadways, easily this government has followed this means of transport at low cost and at a very short span of time. Okay, so that these tribes who had their profession as a traders, they lost their livelihood, and in the meanwhile they are following certain robbery or dacoity. Okay, so in the same situation, at the same at the juncture, government already passed a activity, passed an act, nothing but Criminal Tribes Act in 1871. According to Criminal Tribes Act 1871, they treated those tribes who are following the dacoity and robbery, treated them as a criminals. Okay, so following this act, they are easily easily arresting those tribes, so that this is a important thing why these certain tribes were against and opposing these policies of colonial India. Okay, so one of the important aspect why the tribals had against the British India. Okay, so before that, we'll see a general definition of a tribe. You are well aware that the tribe was who living in isolation, isolated regions which are far away from mainstream of the society, and having their own habitation, their dress style and food habits. Okay, so it means what? A group of people of the same race and with the same customs, language, religion, etc., living in a particular area and often led by a chief. Okay, so whenever you see a particular tribe, the tribe had their own habits. Okay, so the particular tribe had their own customs, a particular tribe had their own language. Okay, so and they are guided by a senior citizen of a particular a tribe. Okay, so this is totally a somewhat different, they had a different culture, and they are living in a isolation area, isolated isolated conditions. Okay, so that particular group we call as a tribe. Okay, so these tribes were, you find the thousands plus tribes in India. Okay, so those tribes basically numerous those tribes followed number of uprisings against these tribal colonial exploitation and the oppression of the landlords and money lenders and so on. Okay, so and numerous uprisings of tribals have taken place, beginning with in Bihar in 1772, followed by many revolts in Andhra Pradesh, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Arunachal Pradesh, basically in the northeastern part. Okay, so Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, Mizoram, Nagaland, and many other states in the northeastern part. Okay, so not only in the northeastern parts, you also aware certain revolts from the Bills and Santals, and various Orans and Horays and Mundas. Okay, these are from the central India and north and central India. Okay, so when you see other revolts, basically whenever you see these revolts like the Coles, which is taken place in 1795 and 1831, and Mundas in 1889, and Duflas in 1875, Khasi and Garo, which is the tribes of Khasi and Garo who are living in the mountainous areas of Khasi and Garo of Meghalaya, which is taken place in 1829, and Kacharis in 1839, and Santals in 1853, and Maria Goons in 1886, and Nagas in 1844, and again in 1879, and Buyas in 1868, and Kondas in 1870. Okay, likewise, not only the tribal movements in the northeastern part, you also find various tribal movements in the central and northern part of India. Okay, so and when you see the various scholars who worked on these tribal movements, and I will give you one or two points before going to these scholars' contribution. And another major change which is dealt with forest policies and tribal land displacement. Colonial rule marked the first time in Indian history that a government claimed a direct property rights over the forest. Okay, so this was something the preceding Mughals, for example, had not done. The British state became the conservator of forests when it passed the Indian Forest Act of 1878. Okay, so hundreds of thousands of acres of forest lands that Adivasis and tribes had used unfettered for the centuries were suddenly kept in a reserve, a practice that did not change for the rest of colonial period. Okay, so according to 1878 Forest Act, where the forest lands made a reserved lands. Okay, so according to this Forest Act, no tribe had to enter those reserve lands without permission of the government. Okay, so they had no option to get these forest products from any alternative place other than this forest land. Okay, so without permission of the government, no forest product will be taken by these tribes. Okay, so this is also another important reason why these tribes were opposed the policy and they fight against this Forest Act of 1878. Okay, so with the British control of the forests came the raise of moneylenders, traders and immigrants, and the influx of these new intermediary groups led to widespread Adivasi land displacements. Okay, so another side, one side is the British exploitation, and another one is from the British government's British government policies, and another side, the moneylenders and which landlords which is easily grabbing the lands of these tribes. Okay, so because I already given a reason that these tribes were getting the money from these moneylenders and landlords with a higher rate of interest keeping their lands as a guarantee, and whenever they are unable to pay their principal amount with the higher rate of interest, these moneylenders and landlords and jamindars, they are easily grabbing the lands of tribes. Okay, so one side grabbing the lands of the tribe from these people, moneylenders and tribe, moneylenders and landlords, and another side the policies of British government. Okay, so one is due to this modernization of the transport and the construction of these railway lines and roadways, and one side which is making all those forest land as a reserve land. Okay, so at the same moment, all these factors which make these tribes to a alone. Okay, so and any violation of these things, these people were easily arrested by the British government and which are kept in a jails. Okay, so these are the important factors why these important tribal movement has taken place in British India. Okay, so these are only some of the major changes instituted during the colonial period, development such as the introduction of money rather than a barter economy, and also transformed the nature of tribal society during the course of British rule. And one more thing is, you are well aware that up to the entry of the Europeans in India, the whole Indian society is under a traditional form of their economy. Okay, so traditional form of village system is nothing but the self-sufficient economy. Okay, so after entry of these Britishers, certain important changes taken place in the economy basically. Okay, so where they introduced commercial crops, and again the commercial crops were which is selling in the open markets, and in the open markets they are selling only those crops for the only money purpose. Okay, so in the earlier sense, in the earlier times, these people were only followed growing of these food crops, and those food crops may be stored for the future purpose, and the remaining things, remaining grain or crops may be giving to other for their required material. Okay, so that they followed only the barter system instead of any money transaction or like that. Okay, so they never see such a money many centered market said that. Okay, so they are they are new to this money centered market, and these money centered market created certain hurdles to these tribes mainly in their livelihood. Okay, so for their survival. Okay, so that these are the important reasons why this tribal movement has taken place in India, and consequently revolts among the indigenous population became a routine occurrence during colonialism, and especially in the 19th century. Okay, so when you see an example, in 1855 Santal were rebelled, in 1868 Naik Das revolted, in 1873 the Kolis revolted, in 1895 the Birsas revolted. Okay, so this is only small a smattering of all total number of conflicts, and you find many number of revolts which taken place in India, which already we seen in the earlier slide. Okay, so and colonial administrators were only directly governed 3/4 of the population of India, and the remainder lived in a semi autonomous princely states, and these did not experience nearly the same level of tribal discontent or the conflict. Okay, so despite having a reputation as a feudal autocrats, many princes pursued liberal policies towards the same tribal groups that rebelled in British in India. Okay, in the Rajputana, for example, both the Bill and Maina tribes were incorporated into structure of the princely government because Rajput leaders recognized them as a original inhabitants of the land, and these tribes were also charged with ceremonial placing Rajadilaka, a red powder mark used during the coronation process, on the brow of the newly crowned king. In Jaipur, the Mainas were designated the guardians of the royal treasury. Okay, so in the Travancore and Cochin, tribal groups were given ownership of their land, government subsidies to improve it, and were shielded by special policies that limited the imposition of the outsiders, who were a major problem of Adivasis brought to British India. Okay, so likewise, these are certain things which taken place in each and every part of British India at that time. Okay, so when you see, whenever these the things which happened in various places, and we may divide these tribal revolts, which is into the three phases basically. Okay, so like the movements which do exploitation by the outsiders, like the Santals and Mundas. Okay, where the Santals and Mundas were revolted against these moneylenders like Shaukaris and Baniyas. Okay, so where these are the outsiders, and gradually they are entering in these Santals and these Munda regions, and finally dominated over the Santals and Mundas. Okay, so and these movements due to economic deprivation, like those of the Gonds in Madhya Pradesh and Mahars in the Andhra Pradesh, and movements due to separatist tendencies like Nagas and Garos of Mizoram and Mizos also. Okay, so the tribal movements may also classified at the basis of their orientation into four types. One is the movement seeking political autonomy and formation of a state like the Nagas, Mizos of Jharkhand. And another one is the agrarian movements. Here agrarian movements is nothing but their factors which is from the agrarian side. Okay, so agricultural related factors which made these tribes to fight against the British. And next one is forest based movements, in a sense this due to making of the forest as a reserve which these people, the tribes which are living in the forest were fight against these Britishers. And one more is socio-religious or socio-cultural movements. Okay, so the Bhagat movement among the Bhils of Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, movement among the tribes of South Gujarat, or Raghunath Murmu's movement among the Santals. Okay, so socio-religious movements in the sense where their traditions are the customs which abolished by the British government. Okay, so like when you see the important thing, basically important thing in the sense for instance you take Cones of Orissa, where they followed human sacrification is one of the aspect. Okay, so which the human sacrification human sacrifice which is banned by the British government because it is a inhuman, and the Cones which led against the British. Okay, so not only that, certain important things, basically any blind beliefs or superstitions which are followed by the various tribes which were condemned by this British government and banned, abolished by the British government, and due to these things as taking as a consideration, these important tribes and tribes which revolt against the British. Okay, so these are such a important movements which basically started in areas of the tribes. Okay, so when we also had so we may be divided into these into by taking consideration of various factors also, we may these divide into the ethnic rebellions and reform movements, and also political autonomy movements, and also secessionist movements, and also agrarian unrest. Okay, so we may also divide or classified into these movements, and we also had other categorization of these tribal movements, like the religious and social reform movements, movements for separate statehood, and insurgent movements and cultural rights movements also. Okay, so and according to Ghanshyam Shah, which is classified these tribal movements into the three groups. One is the ethnic and agrarian and political autonomy. Okay, so likewise, we had the number of movements, and we'll see the various scholars who worked on these tribal movements basically. Okay, so you are well aware that A.R. Desai, who had a great work on this tribal and pigeon movements, and Kathleen Goff, and also Rajit Guha, one of the subaltern historian who have treated tribal movements after independence as a pigeon movements. And one more thing you have to observe here, that some tribal movements, which is turned into the pigeon movements, and also the some movements had nature of the both things, okay, tribe and present things. And the one more pioneer is K. Singh, who had the number of books over these various tribal people. He has criticized such approach because of nature of tribal social and political organization, their relative social isolation from the mainstream, their leadership pattern and modus operandi of their political mobilizations. Okay, so K. Singh is one of the pioneer in the tribal writer. Okay, so we had number of books on the tribes. Okay, so and after that, when you see the nature of tribal revolts, tribals community conscious is somewhat strong when compared to the other people, because they had a strong will. And one more thing is they are living far away from a main society, so that they have a unity. And if and they are all are living under a guidance of a tribal chief. Okay, so this is and the tribal chief, according to the direction of the tribal chief, the whole tribe may follow. Okay, so and gradually these communities had certain consciousness, and the consciousness also somewhat strong. Okay, so and due to that consciousness, this revolt had somewhat widespread and extended to the other parts other than these tribal areas also. And tribal movements were not only agrarian but also forest based. We already discussed, due to this ban of these tribal people entering in these reserve forests and getting the tribal products, which is a important reason for the this movement basically. Okay, so and some revolts were ethnic in nature, as these were directed against the jemindars, money lenders and petty government officials, who are not only their exploiters but also alliance too. Okay, so because we already discussed that this tribals were living in a certain criteria where they had the isolation without any relation with the other people. Okay, so at the same moment, gradually these money lenders and jemindars and landlords have a relation with these people gradually, and gradually giving money to those people, because the tribal people were lack of the money. And this is the main reason why these people were treat that there is a certain involvement or interfere of other people in their own ethnic race. Okay, so and this treated as the important thing, reason why these why they were fight against the jemindars and money lenders. Okay, so we'll see these things in a detailed manner in the next classes. And next one is, these are the reasons when the tribals were unable to pay their loan or the interest thereon, money lenders and landlords aspersed their lands. Okay, the tribal thus became tenants on their own land and sometimes even bonded labor also. Okay, so because their own land was grabbed by these bunny lenders and jamindars, and after losing their own land to the money lenders and jamindars and landlords, and the tribals were working as a laborers in their own land. Okay, so and which became a unique thing in the tribal movements, and the police and revenue officers never helped them because these people were illiterate and they don't have any income and money source. So that the police and revenue officers also supported these people like the money lenders and jamindars because of certain political pressure or their political relation and economical or financial relations. On the contrary, they also used the tribals for personal and government work without any payment. Okay. So, and when you see other things, the courts were not only ignorant of the tribal agrarian system and customs, but also were unaware of flight of the tribals. And at that time, you are aware that certain important courts also worked at that time, municipal courts and taluka courts and certain courts also you are aware. But due to the illiteracy of these tribes, they never challenged these things in the courts. Okay, so not even the courts also not taken these as their consideration. Okay, not even basically the courts also ignorant of these things at that time. Okay, so this is also another cause why the tribals fight against these people, and all these factors of land alienation and aspiration and forced labor, minimum wages, and land grabbing compelled by many tribes like Munda, Santals, Kol, Bills, Warli, etc. In many regions like Assam, Orissa, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Bihar, Maharashtra, who fight against these people basically. Okay, so and the management of forests also led some tribes to revolt, as forests in some regions are the main source of their livelihood, and British government had introduced certain legislations permitting merchants and contractors to cut the forest also. And these rules not only deprived the tribals of several forest products, but also made them victims of harassment by the forest officials. And this led to tribes in Andhra Pradesh and some other areas to launch certain movements like the Rampa Rebellion, which is Savara Revolt, important revolts you find in the northernmost part of the Andhra Pradesh. Okay, so these are the things about this movement, and these are the certain common features of these tribal revolts. And from next class onwards, we'll see tribal revolts in a detailed manner. And before that, we have a general introduction over the peasant revolts and peasant movements, and then we'll move to the tribal and tribal movements. Okay, dear students, are you hearing? Vinipistunda?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, right. So this is end of my class today. And tomorrow in the next class, we'll going to see about general introduction over these peasant movements, right? Have you any doubts or queries regarding this? Any doubts, Sunaya? Say yes or no. If no, I will end my class. Okay, right. So I am going to ending my class now. Thank you. Thank you very much.